Welcome to Hopeman, a small village on the Moray coast. I'm Dave, a volunteer with Elgin Museum Geology Group, and we're here today to look at some ancient desert sandstones. These sandstones were laid down 250 million years ago in the Permian period, where Scotland lay at about 20 degrees north and experienced far windier and hotter conditions than we see today. Gives its name to the sandstone formation that can be found across this area. These sandstones have yielded important fossils from sites shown on this map. This sketch shows the coastal dunes banked up against older rocks to the south. Although this was a desert environment, there would have been seasonal rainfall, giving rise to ephemeral lakes and streams. Desert or aeolian sandstones are deposited by the wind, which builds up sand dunes layer by layer. As well as building a dune, over time the sand can be eroded by wind and another dune will be deposited on the remains of the older surface. This results in cross-bedding as seen here. This is an example of normal bedded sandstone. At Hopeman, however, we can examine beautiful exposures of deformed sandstone. A very unusual and interesting deposit in the Hopeman sandstones. This bed of rock that I'm sitting on is proposed to be what they call an injectite. It's of interest to people in the oil industry because of its potential as a very good oil reservoir rock. The bed I'm standing on, very thinly bedded sandstone with a nice ripple bed beneath my feet, indicative that there used to be an ephemeral lake here, a shallow lake, a seasonal lake after some rainfall. And it's thought that after this rainfall there would have been wetted sands just below my feet here being squeezed upwards through sand dikes. Because a sandstone dike here coming through, feeding into this bit, another sandstone dike here feeding through the lead thinly bedded sandstones into depositing this thickly bedded injectite layer. Another nice example of a sandstone dike is in the sunshine through there, and you can see how it's been cutting through the thinly bedded rocks quite nicely. The whole deposit is a very, very swirly, deformed bed of homogeneous sandstone, and here and there you can see bits of this thinly bedded sand which has been caught up and assimilated into this deposit. Here we have further evidence of this ephemeral river flowing down through the dune areas. Probably a seasonal river, maybe flowing after a flood event. You can see some beautifully preserved ripple marks in this bed of sandstone, showing that the flow was coming from the south in towards the lowlands over to the north there. We do have some interesting features in this bed. These elongated striations here. Very open to question what these things are. It could be vegetation that's been brought down by the flood, and the vegetation has left these striations in this bed of pebble-marked sandstone. Desert sandstones, here we are standing on some thinly bedded river sandstones. We've got ripple marks, thinly bedded sandstone showing layers of pebbles, all indicative of a river flowing from the south down towards the north where the coastal plain would have been. If we look at this upstanding block here, we can see how a storm has brought down some thickly bedded sandstone, cutting through the thin layers and resulting in this much thicker, massive sandstone from a flood deposit. The flood presumably having brought down a great deal of sediment. We'll be talking about quarrying, and if I walk on the other side, there's evidence of quarrying even on this big block. And even here, the quarrymen have taken anything that was suitable for building, they've taken away. These quarry marks are plug and feather marks, probably indicative of quarrying from a couple of hundred years ago. Thank you. As well as evidence of quarrying, here's another example of the human activity that was along this coastline a few hundred years ago. We've got an abandoned millstone here. This rock was very suited to making millstones. We've got a nice centre point, and it's been abandoned. Presumably, there was a flaw in this rock that the quarrymen could notice, and it made it unsuitable for its intended purpose. See a nice example of folded Hopeman sandstone. It's thought that this dune bed slid from the south along a horizon of wetted sands. It slid downstream and folded into this nicely symmetrical shaped basin, a syn-form. Because of a lack of space, you can see that the top bit of this syn-form has actually been forced upwards into an anti-form. You can see that dome structure, and this is an inversion. This basin to my right starts to go from steeply bedded rocks where I'm sitting into more horizontally bedded rocks towards the sea. This stretch of coastline is actually full of these features, showing that there was a massive landslide, possibly after a storm event. Here we have another example of fluidized rock being injected upwards through normal bedded rock. At my feet there's a series of very small sandstone dikes, and they've injected this structureless sandstone here. What we have here with this circular feature, around about 1 meter across, is a proposed sand volcano, where you can imagine the sand has been squirted upwards in the central portion of this volcano, upturning these beds into this vertical orientation. So here's a sand volcano. This is another feature associated with the fluidization of wetted sands. Behind me, there could well have been a huge star dune about 100 meters to the south of us, maybe 100 feet high. And it's thought that after a seasonal heavy rainfall event, there could well have been wet sand slumping down the northern side of this dune and being forced upwards. And here we can see horizontal bedding being forcibly forced upwards into this vertical structure, a very similar structure just to my right over there. The sands are very fine-grained, it's a siltstone, and they're called dewatering structures as this wetted sand has been forced up, but it could also be an air escape structure as well. This has been a useful and informative excursion along the Hopeman coast. All of these localities are easily to get to from the coastal path, which follows just a few metres from the coast here. And if you want to know more, please visit Elgin Museum.